Prepare yourself for the terror. The prison of madness, where few enter and none return.
Welcome to Unsung Horrors. With Lance. And Erica.
Leave all your sanity behind. It can't help you now.
Welcome to another episode of Unsung Horrors, the podcast where we discuss underseen horror movies, specifically those which have fewer than 1,000 views on Letterboxd. I'm Erica.
I'm Lance.
And before we jump into our movie, I just wanted to say thanks to everyone who has supported the Indiegogo campaign for The Sweetest Taboo, an unapologetic guide to child kills in film. As of this recording, there are 136 backers, and it's at 169% funded.
Nice. 69.
And yeah, I've got an extra perk coming in soon that I'll be sharing, and that's going to be available for the first 150 backers. So if you haven't jumped in there yet, now's the time to make sure you get that little extra perk.
14 backers away, people.
Yeah. My dad just backed the campaign.
Awesome.
And he was like, who's Anthony Wong? And I'm like, you know what? Never mind, Dad. Just thanks for
he was reading about backing. The potholders or
yeah, whatever. He was like, who, what? And I'm like, that's sold out anyway, Dad. Don't worry about it. Just yeah, thanks. Jaws is good. Thank you, Dad. I don't know. Maybe I'll tell him to listen to this episode because we'll be talking about Anthony Wong.
So. Yeah. And you should get him maybe for like a Christmas present or a birthday present. Just give him like Ebola syndrome, or the untold story. Here's Anthony Wong.
I don't even think my dad has a DVD player. I think he still just has his VCR.
So it'll be a combo gift.
Yeah.
DVD player with, he'd appreciate some, you know, Cat 3.
We'll see. He might. I don't know. I saw Pulp Fiction in the theater with my dad when it came out, and like he laughed his ass off. He loved that movie. So. That's as far as I've gotten with him. But all right. So speaking of Anthony Wong, this episode, we are talking about The Demon's Baby from 1998. This is one of the films included in the recent Vinegar Syndrome box set made in Hong Kong, Volume 1.
Yeah.
So that's where you can watch it. It will likely be on Tubi in the coming months. That generally happens with Vinegar Syndrome and Severn releases. It is also on YouTube at the moment, though, you know, subtitles are they're fine. They're
you get the message for
you get
sure.
The message, yeah,
but you can I think you can actually like reading this because I did watch that version, you can interpret it better based on what's being presented. You could be like, okay, I think they meant this, obviously.
Yeah, exactly. And as of this recording, it has 96 views on Letterboxd.
That's it.
That's way down there.
But I think this might be the lowest numbered like views.
It's one of them. Yeah, there might be another one that's pretty low, but yeah, this is one of the lowest viewed movies that we've ever covered.
Yeah. I think Arne Madsen's Vax Dachen was one of my lowest ones.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That was pretty low. But I think a lot of people have just started getting their Vinegar Syndrome shipments as we're recording this. So that'll probably jump up pretty quickly soon. I think a lot of people are excited to jump into that whole set. I know I can't wait to see the other two that are on there.
Yeah, same.
So originally, the box set was being promoted as a Category 3 set. In Category 3 films, it's kind of like the United States rated R, sometimes X version. If you want an explanation of that, the Hong Kong set has a great essay from Bruce Holacek that you can read and get a complete rundown on the different categories and rating system and pretty much how it doesn't really mean anything because some films have elements that you would think would make it a Category 3, but they're a 2B and vice versa. So doesn't mean anything. Just watch movies and enjoy them for what they are. But if you are a person who cares about that, whether this movie itself is a Category 2B or a 3 is actually a matter of which website you look on. Possibly the most reliable would be the HKMDB, which is like the Hong Kong IMDB. This has this listed as a Category 2B, which I think that's correct. Because there is some gore in it, but it's really nothing that I would think is anything overly offensive.
Right. And I mean, are the categories based too on release, like the release year? Like, are they less lenient?
Not necessarily, because there are still movies that are coming out now that are, this is like their rating system. This is like our R, PG, PG-13, et cetera.
Right.
And even if when they instituted their rating system, they retroactively went back and rated certain movies with these. So yeah, there's a whole thing about this in Bruce's essay. So for folks that are more into that, you can listen to that. You can also listen to Twitch of the Death Nerves episodes. They have one on Untold Story and Dr. Lamb, and they talk about this as well in
Sweet.
There. So instead of me spending time on it, I will refer you to outside sources. All right, getting into some of the film specifics. This is directed by Kant Leung. This is his first film. He wrote it as well. And he's only directed a few films, and this is actually his most notable one out of all the ones that he has directed. He worked with Anthony Wong a couple of times, who we'll talk about a little bit later. And I think, you know, without having, because there's not a lot of information about this film, and that's common with Hong Kong movies like this made after 1997. So 1998 through, you know, the early 2000s, there's a lot of uncertainty going on with the film industry. And a lot of that has to do with the handover that happened in 1997, Hong Kong going back to China from British rule. So there's a lot of uncertainty in a lot of areas. You see a lot of that in films. Sam Deegan talks a lot about this in her commentaries of Hong Kong films. You know, typically when films from Hong Kong's, let's say, golden era, and not just horror movies like this one, but action movies, late 80s, early 90s, anything after 1997 tends to get overlooked. And that's because it's not considered like 97 is kind of the cutoff period. So even some of the film reference books that I have for Hong Kong films stop at 1997, even though the books were written in the 2000s.
Right.
So there's not a lot of information about it. Some of the information that I did glean from it, I'll share some about Elvis Choi later, which is super fun. But I would guess that because the producer, Wong Jin, probably gave Kant Leung a chance here because there was so much uncertainty. This is the first year after the handover. And I'm assuming Kant Leung probably came to him and was like, I've got this script. I'd like to make this film. And Wong Jin probably saw, and it looks like this, you know, there's some great stuff in this here. Why not?
Yeah.
Let's do this. So, that would be my best guess. And he gave him his shot.
Yeah. And it's a wise decision because there is a lot of good things in this script that deserve to be made. So, yeah.
So speaking of Wong Jing, he's got over 100 directing credits, including Holy Weapon with Simon Yam, Michelle Yeoh, and Lee Soo Kay, who's also in Demon's Baby. That one's super fun. I will talk more about that movie in our next Blu-ray wishlist episode. Spoiler. He also directed Magic Crystal from 1988. Lance, you would love this movie. I feel like I might have brought it up on another episode, but it's got this weird Indiana Jones thing going on at the end of it. But mostly it's got this like fist pumping synth score that I think you would just get down with.
Hell yeah.
Magic Crystal 1988. He also directed some comedies, The $60 Million Man with Stephen Chow, 1995. But like I said, he's got over 100. You know, those are just a few that I would recommend that I've seen from him directing. He's got over 200 producing credits. He's also got acting and writing credits. So, needless to say, he is one of the most prolific people in the Hong Kong film industry, especially during this time. A lot of people think like Shaw Brothers, Golden Harvest, but this is a name that also should be on the tip of everyone's tongue when it comes to that. And he's still working to this day. So,
nice.
I mean, not nearly as many films, but yeah, he's still working. So, all right. So the score for The Demon's Baby, I'm going to say score loosely.
Yeah.
There's a little bit to talk about with this. So Lincoln Lowe is credited on the film. As being the musical director or the, you know, having composed the score for this. So Lincoln Lode's interesting. So in 1997, he founded Legend Music Productions, which is still around today. And it basically is a company that is for music production for films. That was in 1997 when he was 19 years old. He founded this.
Wow. Okay.
So in 1998, when Demon's Baby comes out, he's 20 years old. And on his website, he's got over 200 films that he is that he has credits on. Although IMDb only has like 60 or 70.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not saying that he didn't compose or arrange some of the background music for this film, mostly the basic stuff, and really like a lot of the films that he did. But, you know, I went through his site, I listened to some of the stuff that he did, and a lot of it is, I'll just call it very familiar.
Yeah.
Pretty basic. There's one certain score in this film that's very notable. There's, and it comes up at least three or four times during the film. It's when Little Fish is banished, and then a couple other times in between there. And then at the very end, when Day Six has the final confrontation, that is Morricone's.
Yeah.
Reworked. There's a couple of notes missing, or it's, you know, it's slowed down or sped up and or done a little bit differently. I'm confident saying that not only because back when I wrote the essay for the Vinegar Syndrome release, I sent the audio to you, Lance.
Yeah.
And I was like, this is Morricone, right? Like, I'm not wrong.
Yes. Yeah. That, and that drove me wild too. Cause it, I spent like the next day or two, like trying to figure out what it was from.
Yeah.
I was like, what is this? That it's definitely Morricone.
Yeah. And so on top of that, I also sent it to DJ Alfonso on Instagram, who, if you're not following, you definitely should. He does the music for the Severin Films podcast. He's amazing. So I sent it to him and he listened to it. And he also had the other DJs at Rendezvous LA listen to it. And they were all like, yeah, it's Morricone. They're like definitely aping on Cinema Paradiso. So, you know, it's not just me going in there and pointing and saying like, that's that. But this happens a lot in other films. You know, we talked about Bewitched as one of like the Shaw Brothers horror movies before. That lifts part of the Phantasm score. A lot of these movies borrow from Dawn of the Dead, Gun is Law being one of them. So this happens a lot. I'm not like saying this is some like wild revelation or anything like that. But there's a part of me that's like, okay, Lincoln Lowe is like listing all these music credits, but it's like, well, not only the Demon's Baby, but there's a few others that I listened to, and I was like, huh.
Yeah, that sounds familiar, Lincoln. Yeah, I don't know, like you just said, I don't know how much of the Demon's Baby original score or music is original.
Right.
But a lot of the elements, because obviously this is not a serious horror film. It's very humorous, a lot of comedic elements. But a lot of the stuff that's added, particularly in the scene where Ben and Day Six are kicking around the ball in the kitchen.
Yeah.
It sounds like it's set for like an animated feature. It reminded me of some of the music. Like I'd watched some of the Miyazaki animated, My Neighbor Totoro. And to me, it sounded like, this sounds like some sort of animated feature. Like it really added to the comedic value, to the uplifting kind of establishing these characters' relationships. But yeah, and I don't know if that's actually Lincoln Lowe. I don't know what is Lincoln Lowe. I don't know what he's borrowing or pulling from existing musical compositions. But yeah, I liked what I heard and how he arranged it and what he stole.
Yeah.
Or reused or re-edited or whatever.
Right.
It works. It works really well for this type of movie.
Yeah. And yeah, for sure. Like that part when they're playing soccer with a head of lettuce in the kitchen, like, yeah, that stuff like that. Like I can see him composing these sort of like comedic, like,
yeah, exactly.
You know, things like that, where it's pretty basic. But when it comes to something like, you know, you hear a Morricone score and right away, you know, like,
oh, yeah,
that's Morricone.
Yeah.
You can feel it. It's the
especially
minute you
at
hear
that
it.
End during the final, you know, with Day Six and with Little Fish. And you're like, okay, what is that? That is so familiar. It's mind boggling. Yeah.
got that out of the way. No, you know, no disrespect to Lincoln Lowe. I'm sure he's very, from what I read, he seems to be very talented and a studied composer. But I, you know, you gotta call people out when you're taking music from masters like Morricone. So, all right, let's get into the cast. So, the general, General Su, is played by Elvis Choi. He's got over 150 acting credits, often as a villain, but he's also in a lot of erotic films. Just a few recommendations, because obviously I'm not going to go through 150 of his films. He's in Boxer's Omen, City on Fire, The Seventh Curse, Holy Flame of the Martial World, Chinese Torture Chamber Story, which definitely recommend that one for those of you more adventurous folks. Sex and Zen, The Iceman Cometh. That one has a Vinegar Syndrome release. That one's a lot of fun. He's also in The $60 Million Man as a scientist. And he's really fun in that he's got like the Albert Einstein, like crazy white hair and that. So it was fun.
I like his look in Demons, Baby. It's very Morpheus from Matrix.
The little glasses and everything. Yeah.
The shaved head.
Yeah.
It's good.
He's also in The Eternal Evil of Asia, which I've brought up as a double feature pick before. And there's this other movie, The Devil's Woman, which I couldn't find a very good copy of it. The one that I watched was extremely dark, so I don't recommend seeking that out. That's one that I hope will, you know, maybe that'll pop up in a future Hong Kong box set down the road. But there's a scene in it where a pregnant woman, is being held hostage, and the man has a gun to her back, and he shoots her through the back, and the fetus shoots out, and the cop catches the fetus and drops it.
Did it live? Is it alive?
No. Okay. Anyway, that was a great moment. But it was really hard to see with the copy that I had. I had to rewatch it a few times to be like, oh my God, that did actually happen.
So that's in the book, Sweetest Taboo.
It's in the Fetal Deviation honorable mention because it's sweet. Fetus. So yeah. Demon's Baby is also in the book. We'll talk about that, you know, that ending a little bit more when we get there. But a little bit more background about Elvis Choi. And this was a fun little like side thing. And it's not something that I included in the essay because there was just no way that I could weave it in to make sense with what I wrote about. So the first time that I watched this movie, I think I probably legal adjacent. But when I wanted to rewatch it, I actually rented it from Scarecrow Video, from their rent by mail program, because they had the DVD of it. Mm-hmm. The DVD had this, I don't want to call it special features, but they did have additional content on there, and it was like about the cast. So I go through that, I read the information on there, and a lot of it is very poorly translated. And common with a lot of, you know, the Hong Kong movies, if you see them on YouTube and they've got the subs are hard-coded in there.
Right.
The subs are terrible. These are usually done by high school girls who've got, you know, maybe two or three years of English under their belt. You get the general idea, but for the most part, there's a lot of words that are used incorrectly or out of context, the wrong tense, the wrong, you know, instead of stop, they'll say like, don't go, like things like that.
Right.
Like, it's just or don't go away. So a lot of things like that. So the translation about Elvis Choi, I read it. And it said something about him having gone to art school and taking, specializing in photography. And it mentioned something about him taking photographs and publishing, the photographs. And so I was like, oh, does he have like a book of his photography? And so I started digging around trying to find the Elvis Choi book of photography. I'm like, that would be neat if like that exists and I could own that.
Right.
So digging around, I eventually found out that no, Elvis Choi did not publish a book of his own photography, but instead he took nude photos of himself and published those. And he got in a little bit of hot water for that after doing so. But
were the publications like a Playgirl or like
that much I could not figure out. It was literally like two websites where I was able to confirm that he did this.
Right.
But so he's got these nude photos out there and he got in a little bit of trouble, which is funny because he's in movies like Sex and Zen where like you can see his cock, these hardcore scenes of sex happening. So I just thought it was really funny. But in the spirit of no pants, I will share these photos on Instagram. You know,
nice.
I'll have to blur out his penis, but you know, whatever. But but anyway, that was a fun little side thing I went on, like researching Elvis Choi. And I was like, it took me forever to finally figure out, like, oh, he did not publish this book. He just took nude photos, which is awesome. So translations are fun sometimes.
Well done, Elvis.
Yes. Okay. So Deputy Officer Lee is played by Lee Soo Kai. He's also in Best of the Best from 1992, The Underground Banker, which is a really great Hong Kong Cat 3, Raped by an Angel, and Holy Weapon, which I brought up before. Little Fish is Annie Wu. She made her film debut in Jackie Chan's First Strike. She was mostly in action films, but also some comedy and romance films. Emotion Chung plays Day 6, who's our hero in the film. He's also in Bio Zombie, The Untold Story 2, and Troublesome Night 3. And a common thread with all of these actors, and I know that, you know, most actors don't just usually stick into one genre unless, you know, you're Steven Seagal. But all of these actors have dipped their toes into a lot of different genres. So Elvis Choi, especially with over 100 film credits, action movies, romance movies, erotic films, horror movies, all these different ones. And even actors like Annie Wu and Emotion Chung, who've got a lot fewer film credits, they also have been in a variety of different types of film. Mm-hmm. And so having a film like The Demon's Baby, where they're in a movie that is a lot of different genres, you know, it's a comedy, it's a romance, there's a little bit of wuxia in there, but not really.
Right.
There's like a fantasy martial arts element sometimes to it.
Courtesy of Anthony Wong.
Of course. and of course it's a horror movie. So there's a lot of different genres going on in this film. And you've got a cast that can, you know, that's up to the task.
Right. That.
You know, you don't just have people who feel like they're a, you know, little fish out of water.
Oh, good.
Zing.
Da-da.
All right. So then last and obviously not least in the cast is Anthony Wong, who plays Ching Hoi or Pal. Over 200 acting credits, one of Hong Kong's most well-known and prolific actors. I love him in these kinds of roles where he's, you know, some kind of shyster or mystic or something like that. You know, he's definitely the reluctant hero in this. Sometimes he comes across as inept or just not taking it seriously. There's this other movie called Awakening where he is playing something kind of similar. Like he's basically a priest for hire that he'll like, oh, I'll come bless this place for some money. But he really doesn't know what he's doing. He's been trained, but he's basically just doing it for money now kind of thing. But yeah, it's that one's a lot of fun. If you want to learn more about Wong, Sam and Charles from Twitch of the Death Nerve have a great video essay about him on the box set. I can't say enough good things about him. He's in one of my favorite movies of all time, The Untold Story. Yeah, it's just...
He's amazing in this role. Yeah, like you said, he plays like the very like lazy madman so well. Like
he's like, oh, okay, fine, let's go, you know, kill this demon. Here's these spells, here's this, like whatever. I don't fucking care. Like, I love it.
I have a few questions about his character and some of the choices. Yeah, well, his facial hair, first off, is amazing in this. And it, you know, the mustache is classic, but it's the goatee. It's a blonde goatee, which doesn't just sit well on his face.
No, it does not.
And his whole look. And I don't know. I would love to learn if there's anything out there like that decision. Was it Anthony Wong just saying, give me that fake color? Or was it just like the costume department or the makeup department saying, this is all we have, let's stick it on your face?
I could see either of those happening.
Yeah.
Where he's like, let's just do something a little different this time. Or the costume department saying, this is all we have. Sorry.
Yeah, there's obviously like, they didn't have a huge budget on a lot of the effects, but they make it all work.
Yeah.
Well, there's one thing too about Anthony Wong's character as Pal is he sleeps in a coffin.
Yes.
What's that about? Like that's just what he does. It's his meditative state, I guess.
Or? I think it's maybe he's just this wandering person and he feels closer to the spirits or the dead people so much so that he's like, yeah, I'll just sleep here too.
Right.
You know, he's like, I know I know more about dead people and how they operate in the afterlife than I do with real people, because he doesn't really like interact with.
Yeah, he seems almost put off by the living, like by their stupid behavior and stuff. Yeah. But so that kind of makes sense. Is like it's just a lot of cool little quirks for his character that I don't know if they're like that deeply meaning written, but it's fun. He's a great character.
He is. He's my favorite in this. And you know, it's a shame that he's not in it more. And I think that's what, going back and reading some reviews in it of it, you know, there's not that many yet, but I'm sure there's more to come. And I'm sure this will be a gripe in future reviews, is that Anthony Wong's not in it enough and he's the best part of it. And I see that. Emotion Chung, or Day Six and Little Fish and their relationship takes up, you know, the first 30 to 45 minutes of it, even though there are sprinklings of other things happening, like Butterfly gets murdered and her body gets discovered and things like that. And, you know, the demons getting released.
One of my favorite things is in the very beginning when they're pulling, you know, all that fictionalized myth and stuff about the five evil spirits. I love it when they're, you know, they're pulling out the gold, when they break down the wall and they find the golden Buddha. And they're just peeking out of their little like antique cases, like like little gremlins, like little Mogwai. I love it.
Yeah, they're so cute. And like the noises that I think they're like the main demons, baby, I think makes that one shriek in particular. Mm-hmm. But like the rest of them making all those like little noises and stuff is really cute. But
I mean, it's very reminiscent of Creatures from the Abyss, Plankton.
Yeah.
Like, I got that a lot, you know, because the slime on the teeth and usually like the baby's point of view and the camera kind of zooming in. And it was very like, oh, this could pair up with Al Passeri's Plankton.
Yeah. 100%.
It's not my double feature pick, but.
Ah, well, I mean, it could still work though. And so, yeah, I think a lot of people are going to be like, oh, this takes too long to get going. And yeah, it does. I completely acknowledge that. But I think that because it's blending all these different genres, you know, it's not 100% a horror movie. There is a romance there going on, and they're setting all of that up. It actually does kind of make that ending much more effective, not only with the not Lincoln Low, Morricone score playing over it at the end, but you know, he's gone through this relationship with Little Fish. They've, you know, they have this cute little, oh, I make you food. And like, they've already named their kids.
Yeah.
And, like,
it works. I would understand the gripe. Like you said, I'm sure it'll be like more Anthony Wong. Mm-hmm. But it makes his scenes, his short lived scenes that much more effective. But that whole buildup between Little Fish and Day Six is fucking adorable. Like all the scenes, like their first kiss when they both like awkwardly close their eyes way too early.
Yeah.
And they kind of smash faces with their eyes closed when he writes her the love poem. Mm-hmm. And then the general like can't read. So she makes up that it's a letter to his mom. Like that whole scene, the way they established that relationship, I think it worked perfectly. It's some of my favorite scenes. They're very boring. It's very like,
it's melodramatic, so it speaks to Lance.
Oh, 100%. And I think they sell it. Like, and then the actor playing Day Six, Emotion, there's cases though where I catch him looking directly into the camera. Like when he's turning his head and he looks right at the camera and like looks back, I'm like, okay, I know, I'm sure the director didn't call for that. And it's, you know, it's kind of bad acting, but
yeah,
it fits your adorable character who seems oblivious to just wanting to be in love and have children with Little Fish.
Yeah. And I think one other thing too, that works with the first half of the film, and I'm not trying to give this movie a lot of credit for setups and payoffs, but a lot of movies like this will introduce something and then never revisit it or never come back to it. And so I want to give credit, especially for someone who this is like their first film directing and writing. You know, there's setups like them playing soccer with the head of lettuce in the kitchen early in the film. And that comes into play later with one of the best scenes in here.
100%. Yeah. That scene is, I mean, both the scenes are amazing. But yeah, while it's happening, you're like, and it has that real playful music. Mm-hmm. Dun, 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 like, you're like, okay, well, this is silly. Let's get to the horror.
Yeah.
But yeah, that callback is perfect.
Yeah. So they're playing. It's one of the wives. Okay. The general has four wives.
Yeah.
We start the movie after they discover the treasure, and the general comes home with his fourth wife. And he starts eyeballing Little Fish to maybe get a fifth wife, but that doesn't happen, thankfully. All four of his wives become pregnant when the demons are released from their jars, because the Golden Buddha is not there.
Stolen by lead to pawn. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. So the demons get out. They possess the general. The general then goes on this all-night fuck fest with all of his wives. And it's funny because the shot is from, it's not an erotic film. You don't see like the sex scenes themselves. All you see is a shot of the courtyard and him running back and forth between his different wives' chambers.
There's grunting and moaning going on. Yeah. He runs, he like kind of like staggers out, goes to the next house. It's so good.
Yeah. Because he gets all of his wives pregnant. At the end, in the finale, when one of his wives is attempting to give birth, and their bellies are gigantic at this point. Yeah.
Too. They're like up to their chin. Like
yeah. And it spews out this, you know, watermelon size placenta or what have you, like type egg. And day six and Ben are just like playing soccer with it, trying to punt it back into her, kind of like in The Suckling, where it's trying to get back into, you know, its mom at the end. And that one does successfully. But yeah, so that's a fun, like, you know, so you've got a setup and a payoff. You've got the, I don't know if you would call it origami because it's not Japanese, but like that folded letter trinket that she gives to him kind of thing.
Yeah, when they're fishing and he pulls the body and that comes back and is a huge element in the end.
Yeah, so he tries to use that to, you know, when she's possessed later on, she's trying to kill him, and he pulls it out and is like, look, don't you remember it's me? And she does for a minute, but I'm glad that it doesn't like complete, like this is not the problem or this is not the solution to this problem.
Right.
Like there is no like love conquers all, like, oh yeah, that fixes everything. I remember you. And like, no, that's not how we're going to fix this problem.
Yeah. Again, you do have to applaud Leung's script. I mean, he makes it work. Like, and it's not just like these cliched stuff. It's just really well done.
Yeah. Having like a downbeat ending like that and having him, we jump in all over the place, but you know what we always do. So
yeah, that's,
you know, having day six, figure out the solution, you know, paint the gold spell onto like this huge slab and crush his love and his baby. And baby's like crying out like, I'm junior six, daddy.
Yeah, don't kill me. Don't hurt mommy. It's got these beady little eyes. So the babies, especially in that scene.
Yeah.
Do you remember Boglins from the like late 80s?
Oh my God. Toys? Yes.
They're like these kind of these soft, mushy puppets. They're a big head with these tiny arms and you put your hand in it and kind of control them. Oh my God. I kept thinking, Boglins, I want these. I think they'd re-released them. Somebody did like a Kickstarter or something. Yeah, the effects, especially the demon babies, reminded me of those damn little Boglin characters. Oh my God,
yes. I mean, yeah, minus like the teeth on these demon babies are a lot bigger. And like, you know, with the goop dripping from them and everything. But yeah, when they're reaching like their arms out and oh my God, yeah.
Their little hands Boglins. and you could tell they're just kind of like this squishy material that you just want to play with.
Oh my God, they're so good. Everything, once it starts, you know, once like first wife comes out and is like, oh, my stomach.
And then eats the dog.
And normally I would be like crying about it, but it's obviously fake and it's very funny. And from there, it's nonstop.
It is. And that's like at the halfway point. So you do have this, you know, a lot of people would consider cheesy and slow, but I think adorable and very well done romantic setup. But as soon as you get to that scene, which is like the halfway mark of the movie, you're in for a fucking ride.
Yeah.
You have all the wives' babies like come out. It's not just one demon baby. It's the four demon babies that come out.
They get, so they're all like they're all still in the belly. So right. I think I would still call them like fetuses, like in there. And I mean, then
One of them kind of pops out here and there, but they're all fetuses. You're right.
Yeah. Yeah. The little fish's baby like flies around and like she
does some damage.
So, yeah. She does some damage. She comes out. So it's weird because like all of the demon babies like live in the stomachs of the wives, but little fish is the only one who actually gives birth. But then it also flies back into her stomach and it's kind of like a kangaroo or something like that. I don't know. Oh my God. One of my other favorite parts though, is like when the general is surrounded by all four wives and they like the demon babies all just devour him. They surround him and then they move away. And
it's a guy with just waving his arms around with the skull on his head. Like it's just like it's his neck is the size of a human head and then the skull's up there and he's just running around. That is one of my favorite scenes too. We have to talk about the general's blaster too. He has this like Han Solo Star Wars blaster. Like when the wives are, you know, the babies are possessing the wives and they all start eating people and all the living animals. He's running around with his blaster and if someone like knocks into him, he'll just turn around and quickly shoot him. Like very, very funny moments.
It's funny because, you know, he's set up to be like, no, we're not leaving. We're going to stand here and we're going to fight. I was in a war.
I was a soldier. Yeah. And he has his gun.
He's got his gun. And yet he's so scared and he'll shoot anything that moves or anybody who tries to leave. Like he's clearly not worthy of the title of a general and not someone that is...
No.
Can contend with all of this. So, you know, Day Six and Ben go enlist the help of Anthony Wong. And once he comes back into it, then it gets even better than just like the wives going around. And there's a good chunk of time where you just see all the wives with people's heads like in the stomach and they're just like eating the heads of people.
Yeah, there's a great scene where two of the wives, you don't see it, it's a shadow that's displayed on the wall, but they're like tag teaming one man. Guy's eating his head and then the wife comes up behind him and starts like her belly's eating his ass.
It's a great shadow scene and then the blood splatters on the wall. Yeah, that one's great.
No, yeah, I loved watching the wives together because they're these very unsatisfied women, you know, with the general who obviously is taking on all these wives for, I guess, I don't know, like the history of like multiple marriages
for
and
his
stuff.
Own ego. Mostly.
Right. For power.
Yeah.
Like it's
display of wealth.
Cause Sarah and I, we started watching Sister Wives. Have you heard of this TV show? Maybe some of the listeners.
No, I did
have.
Watch Big Love though. So
yeah. So it's like about plural marriage. He's polygamist and the Sister Wives show, which has like 17 seasons. It's insane.
Good Lord.
Yeah. I've only watched like the last two, but I knew from the beginning, like, okay, these wives are not going to get along and they don't in the beginning. They're very jealous. You know, they don't like their husband. They don't like a lot of, you know, the other wives, but it reminded me of that show. I'm like, plural marriage doesn't work, you know, you're in for some trouble.
Yeah.
General.
Nothing wrong with, you know, if you got a polyamorous relationship going on, but like when it comes to marriage.
No, like, when it comes to marriage and like the set, especially the scene when he's running to house, you know, from the show, they have separate houses. They tried living together. It didn't work. They have these separate houses. I'm just like, yeah, I mean, if it works, it works. Like good power, more power to you. But all the stuff I've seen, and I'm just referring to Sister Wives, the TV show, and the Demon's Baby. It doesn't work.
If you've got one that does, you know.
Big Love's a good one, a good example where it does work. They have some problems, but it works for the most part.
Yeah, for sure. So Anthony Wong in the end.
Yes.
He shows up. He's got all the spells. He's got the way to dispatch all the women. Like right after the general gets eaten by four of the wives, he takes out... I think two of them right away with some sort of like just flinging his hands magic with something.
Yeah.
Then he takes out another one who she's trying to give birth in one of the rooms and he gets pushed out of the room. And then all of a sudden this wall of tentacles and viscera and blood and stuff like that blocks the wall. So he does his little deal and he breaks down the wall and he goes in and sends a spell in there that kills that wife. Then he has to go and take care of the one with the bouncing fetal ball that Day Six and Ben couldn't contend with. So he just shows up and just cuts it in half with his sword.
His He-Man sword. It's a very specific looking sword, like from the He-Man toys to me.
It's a big He-Man sword. But then he realizes that, oh, wait, there were five demon jars and there's only four wives. Where's the last one? And he realized that they all realize, like, oh,
yeah,
you know, Day Six and Little Fish had sex and she's pregnant.
Because he was shortly possessed by an evil spirit.
Very briefly possessed by, and which is kind of, you know, it's not fitting with their relationship.
Yeah.
You know, that scene where he just shows up and is basically like, no, I'm not leaving. I'm spending the night with you.
But, you know, she's like, okay, let's fucking do it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, she's the fifth evil spirit, the fifth impregnated demon baby.
Yeah. And here's where you get the flying demon baby screeching through the air.
Anthony Wong doing his acrobatic battling. Like, this is like the kind of Shaw Brothers feel. There's a lot of Shaw Brothers elements with like the storm that's happening during the final battle and mm-hmm. the blue lightning, that fictionalized myth that sets up the whole movie. That's right. Very reminiscent. But then when you have Anthony Wong doing his battles at the end, I'm like, yes. This is what we're here for.
It's so good. And my favorite part of all that, though, is when, you know, the baby goes in for like the final kill. It cuts his sword in half and he's still talking. And you see like, oh, the baby's been injured because there's this like green blood flowing from its head or something after it goes back into Little Fish's stomach. And then you go cut back to Anthony Wong and he's been bifurcated at the waist and he just like slips off. But he's still talking and he's still like,
yeah, he's like dragging his body over like to Day Six and like, hey, this is what you got to do.
Like, you got to melt something with the Buddha and do this thing. And somehow Day Six figures out like, oh yeah, he figures out from what Little is told to him how to defeat it with the golden Buddha and melting it down and the spell and everything.
Yeah. Which you have to love because it's like this vague cryptic message that from Anthony Wong. Good stuff.
Yeah. So good. I love this movie, but I think one thing I did think is a little bit out of place. I'm not mad that it's there, but it doesn't necessarily fit with it, is when they are in the crypt, when they're first meeting Anthony Wong's character and they're in there and Butterfly comes back to life as a Jiangshi or hopping vampire.
Yeah.
And then later on, there's more of those. And I get like, it's there to kind of show he knows how to contend with this type of supernatural force. But I guess when the hopping vampires show up, I generally just think of like that as its own type of movie and subgenre, like Mr. Vampire and things like that. But yeah. So I don't know.
Yeah, that was definitely an odd spot. There's a lot of humorous elements though in there, like that original Taoist that's trying to like,
yeah,
I don't know, put Butterfly to rest and stuff. He's doing it all wrong. Like, he's really passionate into it and has no idea what he's doing apparently. But it does pull another element that, again, Leung is his script writing, where in that scene, Anthony Wong's character puts bean curd in Butterfly's mouth. Yeah. And then Day Six remembers that and uses it for one of the wives. Later down the line.
Yeah. First wife. Yeah. Another setup and payoff.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
That worked.
It does. Yeah.
But again, yeah, that whole, the hopping vampire/zombie that, it did seem weird, especially since you don't see it again in the movie. It's just kind of there.
Yeah. It's like, we're dealing with this type of supernatural demon thing, but now we're throwing in, I mean, it's fine. I mean, the movie itself is kitchen sink because, you know, when it comes to genre. So,
right.
I mean, it's not out of place.
It's like you're watching a vampire movie and then a werewolf shows up for a second. And you're like, okay, I could deal with this, but you know, I had my mindset on vampires. Let's see where this goes.
Yeah.
Nowhere, but okay.
Recommendations. I mean, I love this movie. I'm thrilled I got to write an essay about it for Vinegar Syndrome Release, no less. Like, and I'm glad that it's more readily available. Like I mentioned earlier, it is on YouTube. It showed up on there. I looked at the video and it was uploaded like 10 months ago. And had I known that was there, I would have probably picked this one even sooner, but I'm glad we waited, you know, until now when more people will have access to it. And then, you know, YouTube is, you never know, could be taken down any minute. So
yeah, exactly.
But yeah, I love this movie. I'm glad I got a chance to share it with people.
Yeah. I mean, I love it mainly because of how proud it makes me knowing that you have your name on this release by Vinegar Syndrome. I mean, you know, I read your essay. It's wonderful. It's really great.
Thank you.
I think it's going to be perfect for this release. I can't wait to see the whole box set and it all packaged together and in print. Yeah. I'm just like, when you made this pick, I think it's a perfect timing. Like you said too, if it's been on YouTube for months, it could be taken down, but I think it's the perfect timing for, you know, just for this release from Vinegar Syndrome. It just works so well because people are getting their copies this month.
Yeah.
So
also it's February and this is a love story too.
It is a love story.
Yeah.
Yeah. There's a lot of unshown sex going on. Mm-hmm. You can hear it.
Yeah, you can.
But yeah, a movie I'd totally recommend for sure.
Yeah. What about your double feature pick?
Yeah. So there's a lot. The tone obviously made me think of a lot of Hong Kong, humorous Hong Kong horror films. Mm-hmm. We're Going to Eat You, which I love. Kung Fu Zombie. But I'm going to go with just an evil baby, evil fetus double feature. Well, this one's more of a baby. The British horror, I Don't Want to Be Born from 1975.
Oh, Joan Collins.
Yes. Also known as The Baby Within Her, The Evil Baby, Monster Baby. There's tons.
There's like five titles for that movie. Yeah.
But yeah, directed by Peter Sasti, who directed a lot of the Hammer horror films. Hands of the Ripper, Countess Dracula, Taste of the Blood of Dracula. But like you said, yeah, stars Joan Collins. I mean, listen to this cast. Joan Collins, Donald Pleasance, Carolyn Monroe, John Steiner. Yeah. I mean, it sounds badass, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, Joan Collins' character, she's newly married and she's expecting a child. But before she got married, she used to perform in these burlesque shows with this dwarf or little person named Hercules. And he really liked her. She ignored all his advances. So one night he gets really pissed and yells at her that she'll give birth to an evil monster as big as he is small. And that baby will be possessed by the devil himself. Well, that happens. She gives birth to a 12-pound baby. And the doctor is obviously played by Donald Pleasance.
Yeah.
And this baby's born and wreaks havoc on the mother's life from day one. Destroying the nursery, flipping furniture, tearing toys, like it's infants' toys in half, spitting at, scratching, murdering adults. He's just a complete monster. He even breaks John Steiner's nose. Yeah. And this is all like, this baby might not even be a month old at this point. They don't show it, but it's still, you know, all that's happening around this cute little baby that they do show is hilarious. It has this really cool sounding kind of Italian horror score that doesn't really make sense with it. But the last 15 minutes are super fun, really going for it. Has decapitations, exorcisms, cabaret dancing, all sorts of stuff. I may be overselling it a bit.
A little bit. Yeah, you are.
I really enjoyed it. It's this melodramatic English horror, this British horror that is, it's way more polite, obviously more subdued than The Demon's Baby. But it's on YouTube if you want to check it out.
This one's in the book, actually. It's got an honorable mention because of like the exorcism scene.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, I Don't Want to Be Born, 1975. Check it out. Nice. What about you? What's your double feature pick?
Mine is one that I actually mentioned earlier, and I'm going with The Suckling from 1990.
Hell yeah.
AKA Sewage Baby. It's on Tubi and also has a Vinegar Syndrome Blu-ray release. We actually talked about this one briefly in our Bleeding Skull episode. This was one of Annie's picks. And it's about a woman who goes to a back alley abortion clinic. The fetus gets flushed down the toilet, ends up in the sewer, but it decides, nope, I'm not having that. And so the sewer baby comes back and starts killing people and then tries to reinsert itself back into its mother.
So. Yeah, there's a similar scenes.
Yeah. If ever there was a movie made for me, it's The Suckling.
It's so good.
Yeah. All right. So, Lance, next pick.
Yeah, we're still in February. Love is still in the air for some or nobody. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's also winter, so I kind of wanted to pick something that had the feel of the weather that a lot of people are experiencing right now. So, I'm picking a Spanish horror from 1965. It's called The Sweet Sound of Death.
Oh.
Or La Llamada, directed by Javier Seto. It's this slow burn black and white thriller about a young couple who are madly in love. Again, another adorable relationship. They're making plans to get married, and the woman has to leave on a trip by herself to go visit her parents, and she dies in the plane crash. So the young man has these premonitions of her death, believes that she's still alive, even though everyone insists that she's dead. So we kind of watch this young man, Pablo, navigate through his grief and determine what is real, what is not. It's all about the atmosphere in this one. Again, I think it has great weather, winter vibes, complete 180 from The Demon's Baby, because it doesn't show a whole lot of deaths or kills or anything. It's just kind of this mood setting of dread and sadness and loss of love. And that's what February is about.
Yeah.
Being alone and depressed and thinking your love is out there.
But I mean, even if you're dead with someone, I mean, that's me all
exactly.
the time.
So it has only 203 views on Letterboxd. It's streaming on Prime and YouTube with an English dub.
Okay. Dub?
English dub. Yeah. I haven't looked at the one on Prime yet.
Okay.
So maybe it's subtitled. And I think there's a DVD out there. I think it's a double feature DVD.
Okay.
But The Sweet Sound of Death from 1965.
Sweet. I'm stoked. This is in my watch list, actually. So thank you for helping me tackle that.
Sweet.
All right. So I mentioned it earlier in the episode, but if you haven't become a backer already for The Sweetest Taboo, there is a link in show notes for that. First 150 people get an extra little perk that's coming with it. So yeah, please support if you can. Love you all who already have. And if you're not already, you can follow this podcast on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook at Unsung Horrors. You can follow me on Letterboxd, Instagram, and Twitter for the time being at Hex Massacre.
I'm on Instagram and Letterboxd at El Shibe.
Thanks everyone for listening. We'll see you back next episode for La Llamada.
Yes. Bye.
Bye.
Sun. You're listening to the Prescribed Films Podcast Network, home to hundreds of hours of free podcast entertainment. The shows on this network all have a common goal, providing you with the best discussions about movies and other forms of entertainment media. The PFPN hopes to fill your earholes with audio joy. Visit our website with links to all the other amazing shows at www.thepfpn.com. Thanks for listening.